What's up, y'all? Welcome. This is day 564 or 3, making Songbringer. And what am I working on today? I'm working on making Jib never ever get stuck. Let me illustrate. Well, actually, I'm not going to be able to illustrate so well because I've already fixed it a little bit. But anyways, Jib used to get stuck, like, fairly easily. Whenever an enemy had something like this, like these kind of enemies right here, they leave behind a collision box when they die. So this thing is like, you know, some sack thing. It's like it spawns lots of these little creatures, and then when it dies, it still leaves behind an area where you can't walk over it. It's a solid object. So Jib would get stuck on those because the way Jib's pathfinding used to work is that it would rely on the tiles, the tile data. So basically the area has about 20 by 20 tiles, and those tiles determine what goes at that particular location. Like, for example, you know, right here there's a chest tile. Right here there's no tiles. Right here there's a little bit of water. Here's some walls. All those tiles were used to do the pathfinding, but that didn't quite work because you had dynamic entities, like, you know, like for example this sack thing here that's left behind. You know, the game didn't know that there was going to be that there. So basically the collision system now has been improved, so the pathfinding all relies on collision data live. So basically, Jib can pathfind around that sack right there. He just did it twice. And another real huge improvement to that is that basically, if Jib wanted to pathfind before, Jib wasn't able to pathfind over water or sky because that wasn't part of the tile data. So basically, it's just like a huge improvement to use the live collision data. So Jib can just, he's a badass. He can get around anything. He knows the whole area live the way it's supposed to be. Even during a boss fight, he can pathfind around enemies and things like that if need be. So so the next thing I want to do is make it so he's guaranteed, like, there, even though he's got great pathfinding now, there's still a possibility, like somehow, let's say the pathfinding system does fail, or he's in some kind of situation where you never expected it, but he's just totally stuck somehow. What's the solution there? Because I want to make it so he never, ever, ever gets stuck. That was a really good pathfind right there. That's cool. So anyways, to make that happen, he's got this little trick up his sleeve where basically, if he gets stuck for a while, like if he didn't have pathfinding right there, he would have actually gotten stuck in the previous version of the game, right? He would have just been kind of, his color turns red. You can actually see it's actually working on that little subsystem there. When he turns red, that means he's sort of stuck. So as I walk around this little thing here, you can see he turns red a little bit. Basically, that system can, if he gets stuck enough and he's trying to scan something, he can go into a mode where he can walk through walls. So he turns off all of his collision detection basically and just walks through walls anyways. And it usually barely ever happens, so you never really see it happen. You're never really conscious that Jib just walked through a wall. But he does that sometimes if he needs to. So that's the thing here, is like, if there's things remaining to be scanned, if there's like enemies and stuff like that on the screen that have not been scanned, and it's been a while, like a second or 2 seconds have elapsed since that started, and he hasn't scanned something within those 2 seconds, then he's gonna turn into that whole walking through walls Jib. So I need a situation where I can test that. Or maybe I don't. I'll start coding it, maybe. What's up, T? How you doing, man? What's up, Waylon? A-star, with a jump point search. I don't know what a jump point search is. Can you explain that to me? I'm using A-star. And I'm using flood fill for some things, but not in that pathfinding. The pathfinding only uses A-star. Okay, so Jibs AI, that's in mood jib. It's the one area of the game where it's coded. I actually wrote this in C++ rather than writing it in the game's behavior trees. Like, for example, Vel, all her pathfinding and everything is done with behavior trees, which is pretty awesome to have it all in a file that you can change without recompiling, which is great. Sweet, Teak, your 3D engine is coming along. Right on. Are you enjoying it? Live Studios, Dieharders, Wolfrock, what's up? Okay, so don't need this file. All right, so in Jibs AI, he's already got this little system where he can walk through walls. I basically just need to make it so it starts to track when he starts to track if he's has stuff to scan. Actually, yeah, here's where it starts getting into this bit. Nice, you're gonna use for all your future games? Sweet, dude, you're gonna stress test it, right on. Yeah, cool. That's exciting. Okay, so I gotta refresh my memory on how all this AI works so that I can put in this little bit where it tracks how long. Oh, here we go. Find closest item status. Oh, it puts it in stat. That's right. Salad, what's up, man? Welcome, everyone. Yeah, right on. Cool. He's stuck in your heart forever. Salad's been using Go. You've been exploring Godot, man. How are you liking Godot? It's been a minute since we talked about that. Yeah, if he gets really stuck, he quits. But this is where he starts to search for an item to scan right here. Nice, you're loving it. Right on. How have you been with the interface versus the C++? Are you using the interface mostly, or C++ mostly, or what? Okay, if it's a sleeping foe or a dead foe, it just gives up on that. But otherwise, it sets his target. That's right. He sets a target to the stats. The item scan place. Basically, the item scan creates an entity. Is that right? Wait, does it actually create an entity? Oh, so you haven't touched the C++. Okay. Oh, right, that's right. You're doing that autocomplete server thing. Cool. How did that turn out? Cool. Really intriguing engine. I'm really excited to hear how you guys go with it, you know? Teak, are you you're not you're writing your own engine. Salad? Salad, I'm really interested in hearing how you like this engine, as a, how using it, if you use it a little bit, I'm really interested in hearing how it goes, Okay, and this is where it gets rid of a target he's not looking for. Basically, I need a timer. Jib needs to know when he started having items to scan. Nice. So when the game uses the G, when they use the GD script, how fast is that? Like if you does it compile to like bytecodes and is it similar to like as fast as C++ would be, or how fast is this GD script stuff? Right, so you've been following development of Godot. Yeah, it does seem really powerful, huh? Nice. You always have lots of tab windows open, don't you? Right. So it works great. That's cool. Ah, nice. Any rules against posting links? No, not at all. Post as many links as you want. Go right ahead. Yeah, it will. That's cool. I'll definitely check it out and like see how this works, the whole making A star a little bit faster. 'Cause I'd like to understand that because I would like to have this sort of in my game development. Thank you. My game development pocket, you should say. Like I can improve, if I can improve my own algorithm, I will, for sure. I mean, it's not my own algorithm. I mean, my implementation of A star, if I can make it a little bit better and understand how that betterment works, then, Oh, it is interpreted. Oh, right, but it calls C++. That's cool. 40 tabs? Three windows? Right. There's already a new tab. Okay, let me remember where this part of his code is that he actually turns into go through walls jib. Use up the path, track type. Oh no, it's in his mask, his emove mask. Yeah, so I need to basically, he sets his move mask. This resets his move mask. This is the if the game is paused. Man, I kind of wish I would have wrote Jib in the freaking behavior tree scripting. Because it's like whenever I go and I want to edit Jib a little bit, he it's like, it's delicate C++ code rather than a real awesome Swift to edit script. But the advantage of writing Jib in C++ was that it gave him a really unique feeling. There's really no other way I could have got him to move exactly that way in a really smooth, smooth parabolas and stuff like that. Oh, this is when he's exiting. Okay, gosh, this is another thing. It's like, he's got so much code in here. Human movement. There we go. No, that's not it. That's when he's, of course, controlled by the player. Where does it disable his move mask? Got this little bit there where he disables his move mask. Oh, there it is. What? When he's pathfinding, he becomes that in that I can move through anything jib. That's cool. That kind of work. That's why he's so smooth these days. If he has a good path. So that's why this line of code right here is really why the new collision detection and or I mean the new pathfinding based on the collision engine works so well is because he does that right there. That's cool. Yeah, it is. It's a little bit different. Thinking back to what Navi would do? That's a good question. What did Navi do? You mean in like Link to the 3D Zeldas, right? Because you didn't have. Did you have Navi in like A Link to the Past? No, you didn't have Nat. Wait, yeah. Wasn't there a little fairy that talked to you sometimes? I can't remember. That's another thing I gotta do with Jib is go through all his dialogue and like try and make him not like Navi, because I don't want him to be like this thing that like tells you what to do and stuff, but sometimes he kind of has to hint at stuff, or somebody at something in the game has to hint sometimes at what to do. It jumps to corners in a straight line to save iterations. Oh, okay. Oh, right. Right. Oh, thanks for the recap. Cool. Yeah, so we didn't really get Navi till Ocarina. That's right. Okay, where else does he say? So if I guess this would be the thing, if you follow the current pathfinder stuck. Actually, yeah, so this is where we would want to do it. We want to be like, if it's been too long since we started having items to scan. That's basically what I want to do here, else if something. So we'll figure that out now. Rectangular search. Interesting. I'm gonna definitely check these out after the stream. Cool. I love algorithms. Algorithms are sweet. I won't have much time for algorithms this month because I got to get some more creative things finished in the game. But you know, once I get to work on some more technical items, I'll love to take a look at maybe improving the speed of the pathfinding even a little bit. I did do a little check. I did do some checking today, and Jib's pathfinding and Vel's pathfinding, basically Player 2 Songbringer's pathfinding, uses less than a millisecond. So it's like 500 microseconds or something like that to do a tiny little A star path search. It's only like 64 items long or something like that it has to do. So it's like, yeah, it's like really, really fast pathfinding. And it happens infrequently, so there's really no need. Yeah. Grim Gary, what's up, man? Welcome to the stream. What you doing today, Gary? So, of course, we need a variable that tracks when Jib started. Oh, we need like a Jib scanning timer, basically. So static double Jib scan timer. equals 0. Oh, right, you're using Java, that's right. Oh, cool, man. Object rebuild? Waylon, yes, the enemies do pathfind too, but only smart enemies do that. There's really, a lot of the enemies are pretty simple, actually, and so they don't really need to pathfind, because what they can do is a simple enemy can just, like, if it can't get to the player, it just goes into a different kind of mood or whatever, and it's like, all right, maybe I'll just hang out over here, or I'll stop moving for a second, or I'll try something random. You know, there's like lots of things an AI can do instead of pathfinding. But the smarter enemies, the ones that you're like, oh my god, this guy's on my tail, or bosses, you know, or things like that, they can use pathfinding. For example, the Keel boss, I won't show him right now because he's one of the last bosses, and so I won't give away any spoilers on this stream. But he does use pathfinding, and he's super on you. He's like, whoa, this is very, very much a very aggressive, intense boss fight. So, and he doesn't even really need to pathfind because you're in a tiny little square, but it still helps to have him pathfind if there's something in the way, you know, or something like that. I don't know. All right, so Jib's got a scan timer now. So basically when he starts having items to scan, then he will add to his scan timer. And that adds the current tick, the current delta or whatever, which we don't have here in Mood Jib. So that kind of sucks. But anyways, we'll just keep it. I know this is right. So we'll do the delta. Is our fixed delta is what we would have gotten past. I don't want to go redo all the method definitions for just this, but the fixed delta is k seconds per tick, because this is happening during a tick. So that should be like, yeah, 1 over ticks per second. Right, exactly. Okay, so we've got the fixed delta. So when we do have things to scan, it will always add to the scan timer. What's up, Eve? Hey, man. How you doing, dude? I'm doing well. Very well. Oh, yeah? Nice. You're making them expandable. Cool. Sweet. Okay, so we've got this variable called stat, item status, stat. We need to know every single time now if there's a stat or if there's an item to scan. Fine so far, nice to hear. Cool, man. Yeah, so what I'm working on today is just making Jib never ever get stuck. I've already, this morning, I improved the pathfinding so that it uses real-time collision data, so it's like way more accurate than it used to be, because it used to work on the area's tiles, which didn't include any of the random possible collision boxes that might be on the screen at the current time. So the old pathfinding actually was shit compared to the new one today. So that's a really good improvement to make. And now basically I'm working on making it so he never ever gets stuck. So if he has something to scan, he sets a timer and he starts counting how long he's had stuff to scan. And if he's had stuff to scan for too long, he just becomes walk through walls Jib, and he can just get to places without any collision at all. And so it just makes it like, you know, he's reliable, like super dependable Jib. He's never ever gonna get stuck. So thank you, Waylon. Cheers, man. See ya. Okay, so I'm just gonna see, how long does this take? Find closest item status. Oh, that's not bad. Let's just goes through all the saved items and compares their distances and stuff. Squared. Cool. Yeah, that's a pretty fast function. All right, cool. All right, so yeah, well, there's no worries about calling this every single time. So we'll go back to the stat. And basically we can call it every time. Yeah, making it proper now, finally. You know, it used to be a system that was kind of rough draft system, and now it's like a proper system. So it'll make it a little bit more satisfying to play Songbringer now, because like you'll never get in a situation where Jib gets stuck and then you're frustrated with him. Because if sometimes he gets stuck and you're like, damn it, Jib, I needed you to scan items. You know, so that's just getting rid of that frustration. What's up, Proton? How you been, man? So if we have stat.index is not equal to -1, then we add to the Jib scan timer. Now, other uses of stat. What's the best IDE for C++ on a Mac? Well, it depends. It totally depends there on your style. But I would recommend Xcode. I would at least try Xcode because it's free. It's C++ and it's pretty awesome for an IDE. It used to be my favorite IDE. I've since then switched to using Vim, which I would also highly recommend. If you're looking at more of a long-term editor for your entire lifetime, I would start using Vim or Emacs. You know, either one of those are really, really great solutions that run on any platform. So you don't have to, you'll never have to worry about whether it's Mac or whatever. You can just use Vim or just use Emacs. And you can do everything that you would do in Xcode almost in Vim. The only thing I can't really do with Vim is debug, except there are some plugins that allow it, so I haven't tried them yet. I do use Xcode, but for debugging only. So, yeah, when I need to do some debugging, I have a little quick little button key, a hotkey that basically opens up Xcode to that current line, sets a breakpoint, and runs Xcode. So it's like basically all my work is done in Vim. But yeah, if you're checking out IDEs, I would definitely look at that. And also, if you're, you know, there's things like Atom. Have you tried Atom? That's a good cross-platform one. And of course, Sublime Text, you know. Oh, you use Vim already? Oh, dude. Oh, yeah. Oh, if you already use Vim. Dude, look, all you got. Okay, so here's the little rundown on how to use Vim for developing stuff with Xcode. Basically, all you need to do is set up a make, you know, like set up a make script or whatever. Let me show you my make file. Basically, what my makefile does is it runs this. It runs Xcode build. So basically, you can call Xcode build from the command line to build your project. It's relatively simple. You know, you pass it your project file. You pass it what scheme you want it to compile. And then, you know, I've got a few things in here that, like, just pass the output. See, I'm teeing the output to my build log, so I've got it to my build log as well as the standard out, and then I pipe it through Xcode pretty just to make it look prettier. But basically, that will build my project, right? So all I've got to do if I'm on the command line is just type make, and it will compile all the C++ for Songbringer, you know. And then if I want to run it, I can type make run. Make run basically just runs the executable that Xcode produced. So that's the basics of how you would get set up using Vim, right? Is all you need to do is have a make and a make run, and then you find a way to use it from your Vim. So however you're doing that in your Vim to call stuff. That is, yeah, Salad. I'm discovering that too, right? Using Xcode for me is painful. I'm like, what? I can't just repeat actions? Oh yeah. So if you're planning on learning Cocos 2DX, I do have a specific thing for Cocos. You should check it out but only if you're really starting to get serious about Cocos 2DX. Because this is this what this does is it basically just speeds up your build times with Cocos 2DX. And I'll share it. It's kind of an old tool I wrote a while ago, but it's called Rapid Game, and it builds all of your Cocos 2DX libraries. So basically, you don't have to build Cocos 2DX every time because it's like 900 source files or something like that. So it's just crazy big, and you're not going to need it all. So you might as well compile it all into a static library. Okay, so if he's got something to scan, it adds to his scan timer. This is beautiful. Otherwise, wait, actually, let's just do it this way. If that failed, he has nothing to scan, then the jib scan timer is zero. So it resets. Otherwise, the scan timer adds the fixed delta. So there, we got a kick-ass thing. And what's great about doing it this way is adding the fixed delta means that if we have slowed down time, it will still be accurate. Or sped up time, it'll still be accurate. Oh, cool. You got an idea. Right on. Nice, man. Exciting times. I love idea times where you're like, oh, I got this idea. Think I might start it. Okay, so I need to check it. Other uses of stat because. Yeah, we already got rid of that line there. This is fine. We are checking the stat. That doesn't really matter. We've got the stat pause. Ooh. So this is only, this is, this was doing this if. Okay, we need another variable here to track. So we need to know if he tried, did look for unscanned. You have no internet. There you go. Cool. Nice. You're gonna get some people to join you on this one. All right. Cool, man. A tech demo. That sounds fun. Okay. So did look for unscanned equals true in this case. So we can make this algorithm or this logic right here still work the same as it did before. So did look sometimes my autocomplete isn't awesome. Did look for unscanned and stat index is greater than or equal to zero. So there, now that's that usage of the stat variable ought to be how it was. Oh, and this also uses the has scan variable, so I'm not worried about that. Good. Okay, so we've got now we got to check if it's been too long as well. Eves, were you asking me here? Tommy Killer, what's up, man? How you doing? Hey, Tommy Killer, how's it going, man? How's your project? Everyone, Tommy Killer just got his project approved, so he's got a what uni are you at? Or where in the world are you or whatever? Anyways, you're at uni and you just got your project approved, so you can have how many people on your team to work on this game? I'm excited for you, man. Oh yeah, Dummy Killer, I just got your report after I had already released that, so it'll be 2 weeks before I can even you'll even be able to see if I can get that fixed. Six people. Dude, that's great. Yeah, so regarding that wall boss glitch, we talked about that after I had already released the latest update. Yeah. But it's really good to know that that's in there. So I'll get that fixed. That's a good, really good bug catch. Thank you, man. Okay, so if scan timer is greater than, I don't know if it's been 1, 1,000, 2, 1,000, 3. Yeah, well, maybe 4 seconds even. Yeah, after 4 seconds of having a scan timer. Whoops. Jib scan timer. Then he can move through walls. Okay, let me review this change, see if this is gonna kind of do what. So basically, I added a jib scan timer variable, fixed delta. It always scans, so every single time the jib AI runs, it's always looking for items that it could scan, so it knows if there is something on the screen that could be scanned, always. And then if it finds something, it adds to the scan timer, and then it tracks if it did look for the unscan, so it can check if it does have a scan in the same fashion as it always did before. And then if it's been too long, his move mass becomes zero. Okay, so now I need something obvious added to the screen or Jib's color. Let's make him purple or something. Do I have render verbosity here? Oh yeah, verbosity. Sweet. So if verbosity is greater than 0, e render sprite set color purple or something. Sweet, you're trying to book a meeting with a business advisor. Cool. Oh yeah. Wow, man, this is for real. Purple is no good. How about just blue? Blue means he's going through stuff because he hasn't scanned stuff fast enough. Right, so we should get some stuff here on the screen for him to scan. Thank you. see if he turns green. Blue, there he is. Okay, see, like, now he's like, oh my god, I have not scanned, it's been 4 seconds, I have not scanned everything. And now he's like, hey, I'm scanning everything, I'm cool, man. Dude, I think this already is, I can't believe it. Did this actually work on the first try? I love it when code's like that. I don't know, there's probably a few things to tweak here. Okay, I need a better test environment where it's like even more chaotic, more stuff, more of these sacks on the screen. Fire dungeon, maybe? Fire dungeon, let's try that. It's the dream! Is it really true? You know what? This is a nice clean check-in. I think I'm actually gonna just commit this so far. Oh, I'll make one little more edit. Let's make this a constant. Yeah, I want to make it so Jib never, ever, ever gets stuck. Cause I want to eliminate that as a possible frustration while you're playing Songbringer. Cause it can really suck if you're like, oh my god, I really need health, and then you're like, you're battling through this stuff, and you're, you know, all this chaos is happening on the screen. You come out of this battle, and you're like, wait a minute, Jib has been stuck there for the last 30 seconds, and I didn't even notice. And he had all these like 10 different places he could have scanned and found health for me. I might not have almost died. You know, it can be really frustrating if Jib isn't doing his job. So I've got to eliminate any possible ways for him to not do his job. And so that I'm basically just eliminating, I'm putting, this is like a blanket solution right here. If all of it, everything else fails, if all of his Jib systems and his AI and everything fails to find items in the given amount of time, then it just goes into this mode where he can move through walls. So he kind of cheats. And it just makes it so basically it eliminates that frustration. So for most of the time, he has a regular pathfinding. He moves around stuff. He treats objects like they're solid. But if he ever gets in a super duper stuck type of situation like this, or he's not doing his job, then he can just move through walls. Yeah. And it's, and if you're a human player and you're playing with the controller and stuff like that, of course, you can never move through walls because you're a smart person. You can move around stuff. You know, you don't get stuck. So, but when it's an AI, sometimes the AI is like stupid. Because it's all artificial and stuff. So this is going to be max unscanned duration. I think I called it just max. So, yeah, we might make it 5 seconds actually. Or, yeah, I don't know, we'll just do 4 seconds. Because typically, you don't go into a room and use a debug cheat key to kill every enemy on the screen at once. So let's play this room like if it were actually, you know, I was actually playing it. That'll help. That'll help this. Test this out. Feel this out. Make sure it's good. Okay, so he does have so much stuff to scan that he is moving through stuff right now. He didn't, but now he's like, cool. Okay. Need a room with lots of spiders. Spider sacks would really be a good one. Doesn't that work okay? Let's go into this room now and start our adventure there. And yeah, I'm gonna check this in so far. It's been too long since Jib started having items to scan, then Jib can move through walls. Okay. So, just need to do a little more testing on this, and then this topic will be finished. Good job, Jib. I'm not even sure if you turned blue on that one. Yeah, once again, I don't even think you turned blue. Or at least I didn't notice it. Did, which is great. That's the whole point. You shouldn't ever, if possible, you should never even have to turn blue. Okay, so let's test this in a better, a place that's just more jam-packed full of enemies. I think I'm gonna try the fire dungeon or the fear dungeon. I think they were, might have been 6 or 7 in this world. Yeah, this is, looks like a good place. Okay, we need to find some spider sacks. Oh, that one's funny. I forgot about that. There's gotta be some spider sacks in this dungeon somewhere. Maybe not. I should do like world verbose. Oh wait, this one kind of would be a good one actually to test. Shit. Let's do this. Okay, that's a good room to try. Thank you. blue. Oh, whenever he does scan something, though. Oh, it should reset his scan timer. And it should be called an unscanned timer. Okay, and so it needs to reset whenever he starts scanning something. I think that happens here at the end of his AI. Yeah, this is where he moves towards his target. Here's where he scans. He sets animation scan. Reset unscanned. Jib unscan timer equals zero. There. So now he should be a little more dynamic with his whole needing to go invincible and all that mode. Okay, that's so much better now. So basically he's like, he never had to even turn blue that time because he had been, you know, properly scanning items the whole time. He found one, he scanned it, he found another one, scanned it. Let's see that again. This time I'm gonna kill everyone on the whole screen at once. Now he's got the maximum amount of stuff to scan. There, he got stuck. Okay. Ooh, let's see what happens with his AI after doing this in the middle. Okay, he did his pathfind just fine. He's scanning. He hasn't turned blue yet. Still hasn't turned blue. Good job, Jib. Yeah. Nice job, Jib. He did that whole screen without getting stuck. Oh, but it'd be better. There's lots of little spiders. I need to let those. Spawn a bit. Ooh, crashed it. Probably too many sprites on the screen. Yeah, I ran out of sprites. Okay, can't really speed up time much. So that means that basically I can change that timer so his maximum scan timer can be a little bit faster so we can more easily go into the blue mode, actually. Yeah, so I'm going to change that to be 2 seconds Yeah, he is. I do, right? Oh, Jim. That's why I love you so much. So let's try the max unscan duration down to 2 seconds instead. So that should kind of like make this system a little tighter. So if it's been a whole 2 seconds since he started having something to scan, if he doesn't scan something within 2 seconds, it goes into this mode. Killed it. I think he ran out of sprites again. Damn. Could increase the sprite. I'm running out of sprites here because I just added this new code that checks if it can run out of sprites. And when you're in debug mode, it does a lot of these extra sprites that you would never do normally. So that's why it's running out of sprites. Dude does it every time. Oh, it's because there's all these spiders on the screen. That's why. Okay, so I can't really let it run that long, actually. He's definitely having some trouble there. That's where he used to have trouble, because the old collision detection system really didn't know how to work around those kind of entities. It's something that leaves behind a cult. So gosh, this is so much better now that this new pathfinding. Okay, I still really need to find. Yeah, but that's also including debug data. So there's a lot of debug sprites. So there's like, that's one thing is I'm inefficiently using sprites to do rectangles a lot. So for example, those, you know, all the debug boxes, those are all just single pixel sprites that I've scaled up. So it's really inefficient, but I only use it in debug mode. So, you know, it's not really inefficient. It's just more efficient if you just use a triangle, an OpenGL triangle, you know, than using a whole sprite with a texture that's basically just one pixel. You know what I mean? Wait, this is supposed to be 2 seconds. How did this get changed? What? All right, let's try it one more time, and then we'll go find another area with some. All I want to see is like two or three spider sacks in a room with some other stuff in it too that kind of confuses, that might possibly confuse, you know, the pathfinding. In this room, there's not enough stuff to confuse the pathfinding. Oh, there, you did it that time. What? Why'd you go for that one? Oh, because, oh. That, okay. I was confused. I thought that was a place you could scan. Okay, good. That screen, that worked out all right. Good, I like these adjustments. Let's, save that. And now let's find an area. Thinking maybe dungeon 7. This is working. He turns blue when he needs to. It's great. Need to find some spider sacks. Where are you, spider sacks? Why am I not stumbling across the right place? Oh, here we go. Here we go. This room. Yes. Awesome. That's exactly what I was looking for. I think this might even be the room that I had the particular incident that caused me to want to do this. I think Jib got stuck in this very room and it frustrated me while I was playing. So, caused me to be like, I don't want Jib to ever be stuck again. Never. Never shall he be stuck. Never. Let's see how he goes. Oh, he turned blue there. Good. Yeah, he's blue. And whenever he's blue, that means that he has not been doing his job fast enough. Get up, Jib. Oh, you know what? If Jib's dead, it shouldn't be adding to his stuff timer. Should he? If he's dead, should it count towards his, like, him not doing his job? Or what it would be like if he did it the other way? Good pathfinding there. That would not have been possible in the old system. Look at that! You can pathfind across sky. No problem, because he can do that. He's Jib. Now, this is taking him a long time. There's a lot of enemies on the screen here to scan. But at least he's not getting stuck. This is kind of the perfect room to test it all in right here. In fact, let's do a test. Let's go backwards in time with code. Yes, never stuck again, ever. That's the goal. I think we're almost there. In fact, let's test this out. I'm gonna go backwards in time, back to the Git log, back to before I did any of today's code. None of the collision. Where was that at? That was right. The music intensity parameter. That's right. This commit is where I was. Let me check that out. Music intensity parameter. I just changed rock area. Yep. This has nothing to do with collision system or pathfinding or any of that stuff. Good. So I want to check out this commit. I've got all this stuff in the latest commit, so I can go ahead and do git checkout that branch or that head or whatever, that commit. Let's recompile everything. It's probably going to need to compile the whole project. So basically what I'm doing here is I'm going backwards in time with the code to this morning before any of these improvements to Jibs AI. Now I'm in this really confusing, this possibly confusing room for him to be in. There's lots of things to collide with. And there's two spider sacs that are just spawning enemies the whole time. So this is like the perfect situation where Jib could possibly get stuck and that would frustrate the player. So let's see if that happens. I'm gonna play through this room maybe a couple times with the old code and then try it again with the new code and see if there can be any more inspiration from that. I really want to solve this issue once and for all. I hope I already have, basically, with that scan, unscan timer thing. It's been a good day. Okay, so we got that compiled. And let's run it. We'll be in the same room, 047. Only difference is we got the old code. So here we go, Jib. There, he's got stuck right there. He's totally stuck. Look at him. Totally not doing his job. He was trying to get over there, but he just got stuck on that guy. Probably because he was following his path, and his path was not smart enough. That killed the spider. That did not kill the spider sack. Good. Jib's got tons of stuff. I don't even know where Jib is. Where is he? Where the hell? Oh, there he is. Now he's scanning items. Keeps on getting hurt. He is really making very slow progress here through this room and getting stuck all the time. Let's kill everything. Let's see what he does when there's no more enemies. Alright, so he still was able to actually do that. He was able to accomplish his job, but that pathfinding was kind of weird. Okay, I'll be right back. I've got a friend here. Okay, so let's see how that went. The rest of this. So yeah, he definitely had some problems. I need to see this at least one more time. One problem I noticed, yeah, it was his pathfinding. Let's see if I go around the screen, somewhere where he can't go. There. If I do alt, well, that doesn't work really. Okay, let's try it again. Okay, So I'm gonna play this one out a little bit more like I would normally, where I'm just like kind of battling, fighting through the screen. So well, I'm trying to focus on Jib though. It's really easy to lose track of him in all this chaos. But if I can kind of take a look and follow where he's at. Oh, I've already killed both the spiders, Zach, somehow. There, look at there, he's totally stuck, right there. Oh, I killed the enemies and now he's not stuck anymore. But he was totally stuck on the spider sack right there. That's a classic example of the problem that it used to have. Basically, it's just, there, he's totally stuck again. Yep, there you go. This is a classic illustration of what could possibly happen with this old system, because the old collision system used data from just the area's tile data. It didn't use any dynamic collision data based on what enemies are actually on the screen. So the new system uses real-time collision data, so he'll never have a situation like this again. His AI thinks he's doing something because he has a path. He's like, oh, look, I have a path. I can follow that. Let's go. But he doesn't actually have a path. Okay, so there, I've proven that. I've even got recorded evidence. Now let's go back to the commit master and recompile everything. Sweet, okay. Now I'm gonna run it a couple more times in this room with this new code, just to kind of like, you know, prove that it's all working. And what an awesome thing to celebrate. Jib never getting stuck again. This is great. I'm gonna start checking off a few things off my list because this is pretty satisfying. I have a couple things on my list for Jib. Yeah! One of them was Jib can't get to stuff out in the sky. Boom! He can now get to stuff in the sky. Because he's got smarter pathfinding. Done. Yeah, hype, right? Now he doesn't get stuck. Woo! Okay, I think I'm gonna make it so he can get an item now. Or maybe I'm gonna do his ice shield. That's the most important thing. And then I think I'm gonna make an item that where he can scan twice as fast. Okay. Ready to run this. Check this over one last time. Maybe two last times. Just two more times. Okay, here we are with new code. So his pathfinding's a lot smarter. He can like pathfind actually over sky. He can pathfind over water too, because his entity allows that kind of movement. There, he's turning blue because he's like, oh, I wasn't able to scan that fast enough. I know, right? Crawl has come a long ways. It was always a great game. Crawl, I bought Crawl like 3 or 4 years ago when they first started it all. Not when they first, like a year into them starting it or whatever. So I think it was 2014. Oh, so it's only like, yeah, 3 years ago I bought it. But anyways, Crawl's always been a great game. And now it's got all this rad new stuff. I can't wait to try it again. I haven't played it in like a year. But Tash, what's up, man? You mean how much is it gonna be on Steam? It's gonna be $16. Okay, so let's try that one more time. It just crashed because, I ran out of sprites again, but that's okay. It's just a debug thing. Oh, yeah, it is on sale right now. Yeah, lots of good indie stuff coming. What are you excited about on the indie scene? Okay, so this is his new AI once again. I'm testing this at least one more time, if not two more times. Just to make sure that there's just no possible way he gets stuck. Trying to kill enemies regularly just to give him some good amount of work to do here. But, oops. That pathfinding almost kills the sprites. Okay, so let's watch him scan the rest of these items on the screen. He's got a lot of items to scan. He's moving pretty quickly. He turned blue there because he's like, oh, I'm gonna, there. Yes, because he was blue, he was able to quickly do that right there instead of getting stuck. Just pathfind it around that thing pretty well. Good job, Jib. He definitely accomplished that little course right there much better than he used to. Okay, let's do one more check. All right, Rain World. Yeah, I started playing it. Thimbleweed Park, that's right. Yooka-Laylee. Is it a decent game for solo play? I can't answer that very well with Crawl because I played it like literally last time I played it was like at least a year ago, if not 2 years ago. And back then I had my opinions about it, but I'm sure it's different now. But it is kind of mostly a local co-op thing, it seemed like back then. I don't know whether it's just better in single player now or not. Yeah, these are looking like great games. You need a baptism? Oh, really? I'll see you, Teak, later, man. Okay, one last test. One last test of Jib's thing in this complex room. I'll play this out as long as I can. In fact, wait, let's turn off the debug data so I'm not worried about the sprites. And I can just allow these critters and stuff to add up. Just let tons of these guys get on the screen. It'll get to its maximum spawnable AI, though. I think that's like 256 spiders basically that could be on the screen. I just killed one of the sacks. Okay, this is pretty good. There's a lot of places for him to stand now. Let's kill everything on the screen. Okay, there he's got a ton of stuff to scan. Maybe I'll do the faster scanning item right now. Cause I'd like for the game to have an item where Jib can scan stuff twice as fast. So like this little situation right here with all these places for him to go scan, I want this to happen in half the time. If there's no way, there's really no way you're just gonna like kill that many enemies at once, but if something like that did happen, I'd want for there to be an item where it just wasn't a big deal. Cuphead, huh? I haven't. What's Cuphead? Have I heard of this one? I think I might have. Oh yeah, I've seen this one. I haven't looked at the game. Is the gameplay for this look really good? Yeah, it does look like a playable Disney movie. Oh, definitely below. Yeah, I really can't wait for below. Okay, I was happy with that. He was able to scan stuff without getting stuck. Now the goal is to make an item. This would even take a second. Constants. Okay, item jib. We'll add an item called item jib. Jib speed. This will make him just faster scanning. Oh, you haven't heard of Below? Dude, it's by Capybara and the team that, you know, part of the team that brought you Super Sword and Sorcery. Right? Was it just Sword and Sorcery? Okay, so we need an item. Oh, this is where it should be. Damn, hold on. Jib light, jib stash, jib speed. Put it up there. Pray. Right? Yes. Sword and Sorcery had that look before Hyper Light Drifter did. Prey. What's this game? This Prey? Oh, it's Bethesda. Cool. Jib speed. Sword and Sorcery? Have you played Sword and Sorcery? This is a classic icon of a video game. Sword and Sorcery is like a must play. It's like Super Metroid of the 2010s. No. What I mean by that is the other day I told Rocket Bunny on the stream that he has to play Super Metroid. The same thing with Super Sword and Sorcery. You have to play Sword and Sorcery. It's so good. Okay, I'm just gonna reuse the jib stash icon for now. Actually, no, I'll actually draw the icon right now. Let's do this. Gotta place. I should just take a day that I'm streaming and just play Super Metroid, just to educate Rocket Bunny. What's up, Cavani? Yo! Oh, I hope there's going to be an Axiom Verge 2 as well. They did? What? Yes, are you serious? This is some great news. There's going to be an Axiom Verge 2 for real? What? When? Oh, yeah, here. Yeah, definitely. When Songmere's out, I'll definitely have some more time for doing fun streams and stuff. Oh, you've been working? What you been working on, Kobarni? Drinks directly from games. I got this funny article up in here written in some other language. Oh, there you go. You're up early, huh? Oh, just work. I hear you. Do I already have plans after the release of Songbringer? Well, it's really hard to make plans when you don't know what's going to happen. So I don't know. If, like, you know, if Songbringer does succeed financially, it'll really open some doors and I'll be able to, you know, I'll be able to focus more on it, the whole Songbringer series. So I got two more games in the Songbringer series imagined. Like, what will happen with the plot of the games, sort of. What characters will be mostly involved in these other games. And how the world of Songbringer will kind of, like, the universe of Songbringer will just play out a little bit. New Zelda, right? I would love to play the new Zelda. I can't really afford to get a Nintendo Switch right now. But that's another thing Songbringer could change. I might actually be able to afford to buy, like, a Nintendo Switch. I feel like a rich man. So it's kind of like the Jib Light. Where's these other Jib things? I guess they're just these Jib Shields. Let's do something with along the lines of these Jib Shields. Jib's Dance Party, right. Right. There's got to be a couple spin-offs along the way. Here we go, Jib Shield Lightning. Okay, so Jib Speed. What the heck? Really? There's a Nintendo Wii U emulator that can run Zelda flawlessly? That's amazing. Well, good news. Thank you for this amazing news, Tommy Killer. I may actually use this news to do something about it. Okay, something just makes him look like faster. Come on, Jib, you don't look fast enough like this. You gotta look faster. You look like Grease Lightning, my man. Come on, faster! Speed! All right. Oh, it's pretty CPU heavy, huh? It didn't look like a safe console. Like, you mean it won't be around later? That kind of safe console? Or like it's a dangerous console, like you might like poke an eye out on it. Really? It has FPS lags? Really? Huh. Man, this looks a lot like the Shield already, though. Yeah, this looks almost exactly like that icon. I can't do that. Oh, okay, I got it, I got it, I got it. What we need is Jib to be like looking like this. Like he's just freaking hauling ass. No, that's skewed. He looks horrible. Can rotate him, maybe. Oh, it's not safe because it was you would only buy Zelda and it had the technical problems. Yeah, probably. There, it's Jib in italics. Jib, you look horrible. You gotta get just the right angle with this whole rotate in Photoshop thing to get. Come on, it's like Photoshop. If you're gonna show me something, why don't you make that what you're gonna actually commit? Maybe there. God, this is looking horrible. It looks good when I rotate it, and then it like looks horrible as soon as I let go. How about there? Ah, I'll just fix it up. Quality of the hardware design? What do you mean by that, Salad? What's the quality issue? Wow, gameplay. Let me check that out later. Yeah, I do. Right. I have scaling set to nearest neighbor, but Photoshop, even though you have that, it like shows you something different in its preview of the rotation than it commits. When you actually let go of that and you commit the rotation, it changes all the pixels that it would have done, and it's just freaking so annoying. One of the worst parts about using Photoshop to try and do pixel art is that is this rotating its pixels. But anyways, you just redo it, you know, by hand, and it's probably better than you would have got by rotating anyways. So this is looking really lopsided. Jim, you're looking rot lopsided, man. There, that looks pretty clean. Yeah, I like it. All right, there's Jim. He looks like he's fallen over. Damn it. Oh, Jib, I'm sorry, Jib. Really wanted that to work, man. Let's try this again. Jib speed. All right, Eves. See you later. Have a good one. So maybe just some really slight, like 10%. It kind of works. He looks like he's fast. And let's give him a little bit of like heat. from moving, like, or some kind of weird power. I don't know. Oh, controller's disconnecting? Oh, whoa. Whoa. Dang, man. I didn't know this. They had that many problems. Layer, new layer base slice. Okay, this is jib speed. Yeah, it's portable, right? It's a big, kind of a big thing. Let's get this rendered out to sheets, HUD, sheets, HUD, all user slices. Replace. Okay, let's make sure that did the right files. Modified a bunch of stuff. Gave us jib speed though. And we can call this jib speed. You can only have one of these items. If you bought the jib speed, how much would it cost? Okay, we need a description for it, an items, strings, jib, light. This could be around there. Stash, jib, speed. Speed booster. Jib can scan items twice as fast. Oh yeah, it's just cheaper to play, get the PC and play games at home. Yeah, I hear you. Oh, the screen can be very easily scratched, huh? Oh, it's plastic. Oh. Wow, that is a lot more issues than I was aware of. Okay, so now we need to be using this item. First of all, let's put it, we should put it somewhere in the world for now. I guess we'll make it a secret item. Okay, world. Okay, but it'll be one of the more important secret items, so you should find it sooner. Super bomb container you should find sooner as well. Actually, no, super bomb container can be there. But sac 3, not as important. Or compass 9 actually is the least important item on all this. Let's put that into the temp items. And we'll push onto this list. Jibs scan speed. Well, you know what? Really want this to be one of the. Maybe I should make the. Instead of making. Getting the sack, you get jib speed. in the dungeons. The dock. Dang. Dang. Okay, so it's not any of these. Where does it place the item for the goal? Oh, the goal items. Here they are. Dungeon goal items. Where did I get those? Oh, past none. Oh, here we go. Primary goal items, secondary goal items. Here. So sack two. I'm going to change this out. So this is now jib speed. So one of the goal items in one of the dungeons will be jib scanning twice as fast. And then the sack item you will find at the store. And then there's two more sacks you can find as secret items. I think that's pretty good. So Jib now has one of the key items that he gets upgraded. Battery extensions. Okay, so now it's time to implement the actual jib speed. Make sure I didn't break anything so far. Jib speed, jib speed. Jib speed passive 90. Jib speed becomes a goal item. That's pretty important. Sack two got pushed back into the secret items. Okay, now it's time to make the code work for Mood Jib. Making him so he can scan twice as fast, or he can move twice as fast while he's. Has this item and he needs to scan stuff. So, Mood Jib. We need to test if the player has. Maybe Jib just moves twice as fast the whole time. Because I want this to also, if you get this item, I want it to be better for the human Jib as well. Wow. Okay, here's where he moves towards his target. Wow. Dark speed alpha. Okay, I think this is it right here. Do we have the main hero? Okay, so we're getting the hero as well as the area. Right, so if the hero dot gear dot count K item jib speed is greater than zero, then we can also multiply speed by two. Let's just see if this even works at all. Oh, I don't even have this item. Oh, what am I coding in this one for? Okay, so mujib. There's a warning here. I think I did hero twice. And we need to have the jib speed item. Okay, so what should happen here? Jib should be able to move twice as fast. Yeah, look at him. He's hauling ass. Yeah, Jib! Oh, this is cool seeing this. I love it. I love it. This is such a cool item. Oh. See if this does the icon work? Where the hell is the icon? We have the jib dead? Oh, the speed booster didn't work. He'll speed run it by himself? Okay, and I'll make this a variable. So I can use this for the player controlled jib as well. Okay, so we've got a has speed booster. So if the player is human, where is that at? Oh, I think if he's human, it's probably just part of his move speed. Yeah, okay, so if he's human, it's he's just gonna use him. Move systems. What function am I thinking of here? I need that tab bar thing. Tag bar. Get any valid position? No. What? It's none of these. Move system. Set state. There it is. Move system set state. All right, if tiles rock. Okay, so if title. Is jib. Okay, so it resets based on his move speed, which I believe he gets set everything. Yeah, his speed 111. Cool. So we set it to what it is, and then if the hero, do we have the hero? No. Game scene. Hero 0. Gear count. Okay, item jib speed. Eat a move that speed twice as fast. Okay, and I need to make sure that hits. So I'm gonna set a breakpoint. Let's try out jib human mode. How fast is he? Okay, so the first thing I need to make sure is that it gets here. It's actually setting his speed to be twice as fast. Second thing I need to do is make sure that it doesn't affect the Jib's AI speed. The third thing I need to do is make sure that it works for the human as well. So let's make sure this breakpoint gets hit first. Okay, so he's getting his speed reset here. Where was this getting called from? Phase open, begin. Okay. His move speed starts with X, Y, 111. Cool. And then getting it set there, still has to be 111, C, 0. Now, if we have the Jib speed item, we multiply by 2. His speed is now 222. And that does not get called again. So good. Oh, because I pulled out my sword. Yeah, I used my sword. Changes skins, so. Okay, I'm gonna go into Jib being human. He's really fast, that's for sure. Yeah, so cool. Wait, he's in blue mode the whole time? Is that right? Okay, I confirm that. I can close this. It's like a constant for how much of a speed boost he gets. Kind of a move system thing. Systems, probably a good place for it. AI, inactive time, psychedelic duration, bomb countdown. Yeah, this is a great place for it. Const float, okay, Jib speed boost equals 2. For now, just 2. I don't know this song. I don't get the reference. All right, here's where he's got his speed boost. Hey, Jib, speed boost. There. So now we're using a constant for that. Oh, I don't. I probably know what song you're talking about. I don't make the connection. Can't. Oh, double D, double die. Oh, that one. Okay. Oh, that's why. I get it now. I get it. Because Jib's like, just running around as fast as he can. Okay, so if I turn off this. And also, he's human. Oh, you're making a dumber joke than that? Okay. Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't get it. Oh, because he's in the blue mode all the time. Oh, now I get it. Okay. Gotcha. Gotcha. There's something where it disables his AI. I think he was stuck in the blue mode because he was. Wait a minute. I really need to check this out. Let's go to a simpler area, like the overworld. We're going to the home screen. Let's test this out without a lot of distractions. All right, here we are. We have Jib. We also have a dead Jib on the ground. This is really great. This is a unique situation that can only happen if you hack your save game. Okay, so he's moving around real fast. But oh, good. Yeah, he cannot move through stuff. That's good. Oh, wait a minute. Oh, when he switches modes, that's the thing. When he switches from being human to being AI, he needs to reset his move mask in case, just in case it was zero. He sees his own future and is mortified by it. Where does it do that? Well, I guess in interfaces, input player two options. There we go. Player two enable. Here's where we're toggling this, setting label on left, right. Cycle input set human. Ah, good. Okay, I knew there was somewhere here. Okay, so we're modifying Vel. We should also modify Jib. Basically, Jib needs to reset his. There's a couple ways I could do this. Could make it so that the move system set state also resets his move mask, which probably is a good thing. Yeah. And then you would need it so if he went from being human to being not human. So we need to call move system set state. From here. Yeah, I think this is gonna be a better way to do this. We're gonna call heroes set state. What the hell? Move system set state. What calls that? Ah, there it is. Game scene set hero states. Yeah, this should be called to make things safe. Now we're calling set hero states. Okay, so now I move system set state. Jib, when he gets reset, his move mask should also be reset. I think I'm doing that here for Rock. Nope, I do that in actually in Jib's code. Okay, so Jib, move Jib. Where does it reset his mask? Here it is. So every time Jib resets, he resets his mask in case the player was human. So if the player's, if Jib was in this invincible walk through walls mode and then you switch to being a human Jib, right then it will be smart enough to reset the mask. Or hopefully it will be smart enough to reset the mask. We'll check that. That should do it. Okay. Time to fix this right now, but damn, I need to. What's up, Wilski? I think I've got to add this to my list, actually. Ay, ay, ay! Things getting added to the list today, man! Wilski, how you doing, man? What's up? Jibzilla710. He can walk through stuff as human. You're struggling with your retopology? What's that, man? What the heck is that? Okay, let's make sure that happens the second time. This happens predictably. Oh, it happens only if you start on the screen below. Wow, okay, I wonder what's happening. Ah, yep. Okay, so that's how you do it. Anyways, I'll get to that probably today. Okay, so to finish this task of making this new item where Jib can move twice as fast. You're making it usable. Are you drawing quads? Oh, cool. You're drawing quads. I see. You're sculpting? Are you sculpting right now? Okay, so Jib should not be able to move twice as fast. I take away this item, Wait, I want him to have this item, but not, but move at the same speed. Yeah. Okay, so hold on. Keep the item. Go back to this room. Ah. Oh, I know. Yeah, it's a never-ending bug list. Oh, you're using Maya. All right. So you finished sculpting. Now you're making your sculpting usable. Ah, I see. Yay! Hooray! Oh my god, Jib dies in one hit from these guys. I don't even know where Jib is. Okay, let's go back to Jib being auto. I'm gonna try and pause it when he's blue. Come on, Jib, get blue! Get blue, you totally know you can, you want to. You want to be blue, man. Turn all blue. It's good. Yeah! Oh! Damn, I didn't quite catch it. There we go! Yes! We're blue! Okay, so now I'm gonna go to input human. Okay, and he shouldn't be blue anymore. Or, I mean, he shouldn't have an invincibility anymore. Oh no, he can still go through the walls, damn it. That did not work. Why didn't it work? Okay, well, let's set this test up again, and this time I need a breakpoint. Catch it for real. Okay, it should be getting, as soon as you switch human mode, it should go into, a bug is just an extra feature. Back in interfaces. Here, reset human player 2. Okay, let's run this again. Kill a bunch of enemies. Wait for him to turn blue. We'll figure out why he didn't reset. Okay, there he is. He's blue. Input's going to human. So he's being set to be human. Okay, we're on the first hero. Here we go. Now we're in setting Jib. Good. What's his move mask right now? Zero. Move mask is proper now. Okay, what the only other thing that could be happening then is if he's getting back into mood jib. Maybe he is actually getting back into mood jib. Aha, okay. So his move mask was properly set by adjusting the is human thing, but then, let's see, we got his move mask is currently his proper value 3138. Let's see what happens here. I'll see it resets his move mask right there. Oh, it runs his whole AI, that's right, even if you're human. Forgot. So he's looking for an unscanned. So it doesn't even need to do this right here. It should just go if is human. Okay, what's happening here? Target has scan. Does he have a scan maybe? Probably does. Yeah, he has a scan because he ignored the fact that he's human. Oh, here's where you should be doing the blue thing. Okay, so where is your thing doing the thing with blue? Here. Okay, so there. And this bit of code, move mask. Should happen before it does this debug data. Shit, still I'm not seeing why. Where the hell is the cursor? Could there be a bug that breaks the whole game? Yes. Kinda. I mean, depends. Probably. Oh, it lost its debug. Is that it? Is it? I lost the cursor. I have no idea why. Damn it. Oh, well, let's try it again. All right. Oh, wait a minute. The e.move.mask. Ah, here we go. So there. That one little bit of logic right there was super important. Because we added this new thing for him to turn blue and be able to go through walls, we needed to check if he wasn't human to enable that. So that's what was happening, was that he was blue. He went into this human mode, and because it was still allowed that, it just kept on setting his move as mask to zero. Okay, that should be a lot better now. So I'm gonna try and trap it again. Basically, what I'm gonna do is kill a bunch of enemies, let them start scanning, wait for them to turn blue, pause the game, switch into freaking human mode, and then just make sure that it's more dynamic. It allows him to have his mask again when he's in human mode. All right, failed. Oh. All right, I gotta close the stream down here pretty soon. But I'm almost done with this code. There we go. Cool. He's blue. Nice. Okay, I've set him to human mode. All right. And is he still blue? Damn, I thought he would change to be white. Oh, good, but at least his move mask is not wrong. Oh, Oh no, his blueness is right because he hasn't scanned anything. So if I scan something, yeah, he suddenly becomes not blue, and then he's blue again after a minute because I haven't scanned something. So he's doing his job correctly. He's showing that he's blue even when he's human. Even though if he's blue and he's human, he can't walk through walls. So yes, that's good. We fixed that system. Yay. Later, Wolski. See you, man. Okay, so what do I need to do to check all this in? This is like almost there. What really did I change this time? Oh yeah, the speed booster. Oh yeah, I need to just check that he doesn't get 4 times the speed in when he has the speed booster. Oh, and I've already been checking that. So go back to player AI mode. So he should be, hold on, I don't need Xcode. He should be regular speed right now, even though I have the jib speed item. And why didn't the jib speed item work? Oh, it's jib speed up. Ping, man. Oh, no, it's not. Wait, I thought we had the jib speed. Okay, so it'd really be called item jib speed. Okay, the last thing to check is the jib speed icon file. Oh, I just called it item speed. Item jib speed. No wonder it didn't work. Okay, things are ready to test now. Basically, just need to make sure he doesn't move at 4 times the speed during his AI. Yeah, he's definitely going at regular speed here. Okay, so that means now I can check in. Where's that bit in AI system? Ah, screw that. I'm not going to change this anymore. Whoa. Move mask. Where's that other bit? There. Okay. So, now he's got the jib speed boost in his AI. I've got this item. He should move at 2x the speed, but not 4x the speed. And I could should be able to switch between human and AI modes and still be about the same speed. Wow, he's super fast. Yes, this is so good though. It's very satisfying. And now if he gets into human, yeah, he can move super fast. He's great. I love him like this. Okay. Now the last thing, I think the jib speed boost should only be 1.618 instead of 2.0 the speed. Oh, and the string. Okay, so I added the jib speed item to the world. It's one of the goal items now. This is should be a pretty cool item to get. You'd be like, yes, jib's twice as fast. It feels like twice as fast. It won't be actually twice as fast, but 1.6 times as fast. He resets his mask and his speed when he gets, that resets his move state. So that allows him to, whenever you gain an item, you can change jib speed or whatever. Also, if you change the human mode, it sets the hero states. Created the icon. Oh, I should check if the icon worked. Good. Yeah, that's it. Just need to wait for it to finish compiling and check it out one last time. I love it. I love that Jib can scan so much faster. This is a sweet item. Yeah, Jib, good job. Oh, he just needs some movement streaks, that's all. This icon is almost done. Yakety Sax. Don't talk back. There, let's see how that looks in the game. Oh, what? What's Yakety Sax then? Yeah, that looks good. He's got like a little bit of like movement streak there. That looks like a sweet item. I love it. Jim can move twice as fast. This is the raddest item. Oh, during Benny Hill sketches. Okay. All right, this is all good. Get this all checked in, and then that's it for today's stream. Dang, that was a pretty productive, like, 45 minutes right there, just creating that item. It's really going to be significant. Oh, that's what it was? Oh. Now I get the reference completely. Thank you for the clarification. All right, well, that's it for today's scream. Scream stream. Stream of screaming. We're gonna have some ice cream now. Oh, Yakety Sax. Okay, I get it. Ah. So, well, I hope you all have a great night. Thanks a lot for watching, everybody. And, yeah, we'll catch you all next time. Next time we have some ice cream. We all stream for ice cream. We're gonna have some ice cream. On the ice stream, we're going to stream and scream at the same time and eat lots of yummy food. All right? Deal. Yeah, take it easy. See you, salad. Later, everybody.